This Is Your Life, sponsored by Konica Film and Cameras.
Once upon a time, there lived in Hollywood a television family who made a bust like this famous the world over. Actually, it was about 23 years ago that a certain young actor was at the wheel of the bus in the studio backlot. And in the scene they were filming, he just had to lean out of the cab and say the line, "Bye, Mom," and then drive off just a few yards and stop. But he didn't stop. Just for a lark, he took the bus right out of the studio gates and drove it on the kind of city tour that we're doing now. But a crowd of youngsters on their way home from school spotted the bus and him. In no time at all, the bus was surrounded by screaming kids, and finally the police had to be called in so that he could escape and make his way back to the studios. And soon after this adventure, he went to London. And this is what happened at Wembley. Tonight he's booked to sing in a show here at CBS, but what he doesn't know is that we made the booking, and I'd better get in there, of course, before he arrives.
David, good evening. You've come here to do a TV program, and it's not quite the program that you think you've come to do, because you've been flown from New York and I've flown from London to say tonight, David Cassidy, this is your life.
Okay, we're... Is this really happening?
Just along here. We have a little studio waiting. Thanks for playing the game.
Get out of here.
Yes.
I'm going to choke you.
Now, you'll be finding out just how busy we've been keeping the airlines. Just for now, from New York, your songwriter wife, Sue Schifrin, and plenty more still coming into land here in Los Angeles, including from Chicago, where he's now top DJ, your kid brother in the Partridge Family, who used to look like this. Let's see what he looks like now. Danny Bonaducci. Danny, it was you who told us about this bus ride, wasn't it? Thank you.
Yes, it was. And I ended up taking another bus ride with David. David took me on the road with him. He let me be his opening act at a time in my life when a lot of people probably didn't have too much faith in me. And it's because of the faith you showed in me that I'm doing well today. And I love you, man.
I love you, lad.
Thank you, Danny. Well, David Cassidy, this is your life, and Life magazine gave you their front cover back in 1971, Teenland's Heartthrob, title you must treasure. In a five-year period, you had a string of hits on both sides of the Atlantic, with no fewer than 14 singles in the UK top 20, two of them at number one.
Daydreamer, walking in the rain, chasing after rainbows, I may never find again.
Make you happy. And if you shake me, go away, I will. But I think better still, I'd better stay around and love you. Do you think I have a case? Let me ask you to your face. Do you think you love me?
You never see me frown.
Thank you.
And the seasons are good, but sometimes they're bad. Not funny how my friend.
And you haven't changed a bit. Now, Sue, David's London concert of 1973 has a special meaning for you.
Yes, it does. That's where we met.
Yeah, never mind all that. Tell us the story.
We were on the same record label.
She saw the jumpsuit and died.
I fell in love with the jumpsuit. We were on the same record label, and I went to a party at the end of the show, and I met David there for the first time, and we struck up a friendship that's lasted till this day.
You were married Easter Sunday, 1991.
Yes.
With an unexpected guest at the ceremony.
A very unexpected guest, our son.
Our best man.
And he was our miracle child. Mm-hmm. As I've been told I could never have children. And my mother, unfortunately, had a stroke. And during that time, 6 weeks afterwards, I found myself pregnant for the first time. And gave birth to our son on February 8th, 1991.
Yeah.
Well, we have a picture of him on your wedding day, and 2 years on, he has a message for you in the Cassidy tradition.
This morning, I woke up I think about you. Oh. I think about you.
Yes. Yes.
You know, Michael, I never sang that song that well, honestly. That is so great. Ugh, boy.
Well, he's repeating a bit of family history there, of course, because you were about the same age when your father gave you the same sort of musical inspiration. He was the late Jack Cassidy, the Broadway star, known as the Prince of Players. Now, you just seen him at the New York's Imperial Theater, starring in the musical Wish You Were Here.
But, David, at the theater that night, it was you who brought the house down.
Your mother, Evelyn Ward.
It's me, Mom. Your real mom.
Evelyn, tell us, how did the young David bring the house down then?
Well, it was a Saturday matinee, I think, in New York years ago, and Jack was doing Wish You Were Here.
I was 3 years old.
Yes, and you were sitting on my lap, and Jack made his first entrance, and the house was packed. It was really one of those packed houses. And David said, "Hi, Daddy!" And the whole house came down. And Jack was trying very hard not to break up, but he managed.
Evelyn, that was a nice story. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Well, away from singing, for a time you were diverted with thoughts of being a baseball player or a racing driver, but the theatre was in your blood. Your parents divorced and your mother moved here to Los Angeles when you were 9.
Right before I got my eye job, yeah.
Is that right? Well, at 10, you made your stage debut with her in the Pajama Game, and as a teenager at Rexford High in L.A., you were the drummer in your own rock band. Mm-hmm. You also worked at the Los Angeles Theatre Company and in 1967 starred in their production of And So to Bed. At 18, you moved to New York to pursue a stage career. But after nearly a year, a legendary Broadway producer-director gives you a break. He casts you in the musical Fig Leaves Are Falling. Right now he's in San Diego planning a revival of his famous show Damn Yankees. I won't ask you now to guess his age. I'll tell you, he is 106, the great George Abbott.
Oh. David Cassidy, isn't it? A long time since we've seen each other. And the Fig Leaves Are Falling. I like that show. Let's do it again, eh?
Hey.
All right. How's your mother? Give her my best. So long.
George Abbott, 106, that's what we call a long run.
He's a remarkable man.
Well, during the brief run of that show that you were in, you were spotted by a Hollywood talent scout, so it was back here to L.A., and guest appearances in some top TV shows of the time, Bonanza, Ironside, Mod Squad, and the FBI. Then in 1970, a one-off show turns out to be a major milestone in your young life. It was all about a single mother who has to work to bring up her young children. It was called The Partridge Family.
Hey, Mom, you're really great out there.
I was?
Mm-hmm. Who even think you're sending you to Washington?
Or Berkeley.
Look, since we're all putting our lives on the line for Tina, don't you think it's about time we met her?
Yeah, sure.
Your screen mother was the popular star of Oklahoma and The Music Man, and she won an Oscar for Elma Gantry. She was also your real-life stepmother, Shirley Jones.
Hi, darling. Surprise, surprise.
That tryout show surprisingly had no music, no singing.
No, the very first show, you know, I'm not sure that they knew how they were going to get the show started, but we were all musical people. And when they told me that David Cassidy was going to play my son on the show, and we were sort of going to be a musical family, you know, we would put the band together and everything, I was so excited because I knew David was such a wonderful singer, and I didn't know the world knew about it. Well, they certainly got to know about it because, as you well know, he became the teen idol of America and was just about the biggest star around for a long, long time and is doing it again on Broadway.
Shirley, thank you very much.
You guys are very good.
We say you haven't changed, but my goodness, that lady hasn't either. Yeah. Now, the Partridge Family is as big as ever here in America. The reruns are getting huge audiences. Now, Shirley's marriage to your father led to an extension of the singing Cassidy clan. And they are here, your brothers Sean, Patrick, and Ryan.
Get out of here!
Now, can I get this right? Now, Ryan works with Jim Henson Productions. Patrick, you're appearing in Sondheim's Company. And Sean, you've just flown in from New York, where, of course, you are David's brother in Blood Brothers. And you've been working on the English accents. You're the posh one, and he's the Scouse.
Yes,
right?
It's absolutely true, actually. One of the most difficult aspects of doing this show is trying to avoid you at the airport. Last time. Because they
you did a good job, lads.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well,
we had a show yesterday, and he was telling me how he's going to Los Angeles to do this interview show, and I was saying, have a great time, you're going to be exhausted, how awful for you. And meanwhile, I'm calling my travel agent, wondering how am I going to miss him at the airport.
I guess you and I will be getting up at 5:30 in the morning to go back together, huh?
And we're not on the same flight.
What?
Well, we can't. We had to be on different flights out here. I wasn't hiding in the bathroom that whole trip. You know, I had my own plane.
Fellas, thank you very much.
Scouse is one of the most difficult accents in the world. You've done a great job of that, as we shall hear, because that is a musical cue for us to go to Broadway to hear from someone else greatly impressed by your singing and the Scouse accent, your stage mum, Petula Clark.
Hello, David. This is your stage mum here in a rather noisy Broadway dressing room. Like millions of others, I always thought of you as a really great pop singer. And I was a fan, and we had never met. And so when Bill Kenwright asked me to do Blood Brothers here in New York and mentioned that you might be doing it, I was a little surprised because I had never thought of you as a serious actor. Wrong. And from the first reading in London, when you came out with a fantastic performance already, and with that great Liverpool accent, I don't know where that was coming from. Certainly a lot better than mine. From that moment, I knew you were going to be fantastic. I love you, and lots of love for tonight.
Now, newfound stardom in the 90s wasn't something you contemplated back in the mid-70s. That was when Life magazine's Teenland heartthrob decided his heart just wasn't in it anymore. You'd loved riding when you were a youngster, and later the thrill of the racetrack.
So, David, you decided on a stud farm breeding racehorses.
And few know more about them than three times UK and former American champion jockey flown in from his Cincinnati ranch, Steve Cawthon.
see you too. You're looking great.
Nice to you. See you looking great. The little boy's going out the best.
He's switching this around. No, well, I've always been a fan, and I was a fan before I went to Europe, and that's where we met because he was over there making a hit record and mm-hmm. doing some shows. And yeah. Anyways, I feel lucky to have been a part of his life. Small
Thank you.
Part.
Thank you, Steve Coulson.
Thanks, Steve.
The chance to play the leading role in a smash hit musical comes in 1981. It's the revival of George M. Cohan's Little Johnny Jones. Quite magnificent, reported the critics on the Cassidy Voice, and that's a cue for us to join another famous son of another singing star. On board the Majesty of the Seas cruise liner off Miami tonight, Jack Jones.
Hi, David. I'm glad you finally got a life so we could celebrate it. Your friend Jack and Kim and Nicole, and we're all here on the Majesty of the Seas. Missing you and thrilled that that we're celebrating right now, celebrating your wonderful life. And I've known you a long time. And of course, your wife Sue is a wonderful writer. You get and Bo, and that brings me to the important. That's when our friendship really started. When we met in the hospital that morning, and our kids were born a few hours apart. And from then on, they have been in love, and that brought us all together. And so. Never mind you, David. I'd like to say that, Bo Cassidy, this is your wife.
In 1985, you head for London to record your album, Romance. That leads to a return visit in 1987 for the musical Time. And there you are on the same bill as that promising young performer, Laurence Olivier. Mm. Back here in America, you make two movies, The Spirit of 76 and Instant Karma. There was no escaping the British influence when you made a guest appearance on the popular action fantasy TV series, The Flash. And here at the speed of light is your English co-star, Amanda Pays. I think you were a bit surprised by David's role in The Flash.
Well, actually, I don't think surprise is quite the word. I think overwhelmed might be better, because, in fact, David, I never told you this, but when I was 12, I was a huge fan.
No!
I found this diary.
No!
With you on the front and inside, this is 1972,
oh,
inside
no.
I've got written, I love David Cassidy, one day I'll meet him, you'll see, I'll probably marry him.
Is Corbin around?
He is!
Aye.
He's in the audience.
Aye.
Just joking, Corbin.
It's great. We actually had a really good time. It was I love playing a villain, you know, because I've been cast as somebody the other side.
Right.
It was wonderful for me, and she was great.
I like this English accent. It suits you.
It keeps coming.
Yeah, it's so
it does.
Bad, and you've kept yours, Amanda. Thank you
I
very
have,
much.
Yes, absolutely.
Thanks. There is someone else who's been wanting to catch up with you for a long time. Once she was world famous as your kid sister, then she became better known as Grace Van Owen in L.A. Law. But tonight she finally catches up with you again, Susan Day.
You look great.
I'm so happy about
that. Thank you.
So
you've been
fabulous.
Watching each other's success over the years, of course.
Well, we try. I mean, it's difficult. We're both so busy.
Mm.
I'm in L.A., you're in New York. I'm in L.A., you're in London. I'm in L.A., you're all over. I'm in L.A., you're having babies. Congratulations. So, like, I bought this for you. Oh. Years ago. For your birthday. Before
1979.
MTV.
No.
Years ago. Remember we were seeing each other on and off?
Mm.
So I got this for you. Happy birthday, David.
How did you mean
David?
Seeing each other on
You know what I meant. You know what I meant. So now I get to give it to you.
You look great.
Well, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Can I tell you something?
Please.
This isn't really your life. This was just a part of your life. And the rest of your life is ahead.
Thank you.
I love you.
Love you. Thanks.
Thank you, Susan. Thank Well, family has been the theme tonight, and now let's complete yours, because here is Bo. David, I mentioned when we came across each other earlier this evening that you've been booked here at CBS to sing, and now, of course, you realise it was all part of our cunning plan, but, I mean, you have spent the morning rehearsing. It seems a pity to kind of waste all that.
Okay,
You'll do something.
You want me to sing?
That would be lovely.
Yeah?
Shall right. I? All right, well, before you do, you're going to be doing what you've done all your life and sing us out, but before the band gets together, let me say, David Cassidy, this is your life.
Recorded this song 23 years ago. It's a song that was number one for me in I think 17 different languages and countries and places all over the planet, and still to this day it's one of the best songs I've ever recorded. Here it is.
I'm sleeping and right in the middle of a good dream. Like all at once I wake up from something that keeps knocking at my brain. Before I go insane, I hold my pillow to my head and I spring up in my bed, screaming out the words I dread. I think I love you. This morning I woke up with this feeling I didn't know how to deal with, and so I just decided to myself I'd hide it to myself, but I'd never talk about it. I did not go and shout it when you walked into my room. Not what life is made of, though it worries me to say I never felt this way. Believe me, you really don't have to worry. I only wanna make you happy, and if you say hey, go away, I will. But I think better still, I better stick around and love you. You think I've got a case? Let me ask you to your face. Do you think you love me? I think I love you. I think I love you. Girl, I think I love you. I think I love you. Yeah, I really love you. I think I love you. Girl, one time.
This is your...